students, in this video, we are going to see how this energy crisis will be taken over. See, whenever there is a problem, there is a solution, okay? So we don't have to worry about anything. We do have resources. It's not that we have completely run dry of resources. But what are the possibilities? That's what we are going to see in this video, okay? And the first thing is, think about alternatives. Think about substitutes. Think about things that we can always substitute. What are they? You have the solar energy, you have the wind energy, you have geothermal energy in the case of places where you have hot springs. Okay, then you have the tidal energy in the case of high tides and waves that we have in the coastal areas. Okay, so there are so many things. Biogas is there. All these come under alternate sources. The next thing is we can avoid wastage. Now that we know, spread the awareness. Yes, do not waste water. Do not waste this. Do not waste the resources. Just because we have doesn't mean that we have to waste it. So remember to reduce wastage. Then going to encourage cottage industries. See, cottage industries, even now, you have villages. Even now, in those villages, cottage industries are possible. If we encourage them, if we give them the raw material, if we give them loans and help them to get loans and then start off, have a startup business like that in the cottage industry, this will require more of muscle power, okay? But less amount of electrical energy and other kinds of energy. So naturally, you are conserving. Indirectly, what are you doing? You are conserving electricity. You are conserving energy. Okay, so sustainability. Then coming to energy efficient devices. Good old days, we had those bulbs where that used to consume a lot of electricity. So many units it used to consume. Now what are we doing? We are replacing them. Okay, we are substituting them with compact fluorescent lamps, CFL. Okay, and then LED lights. These consume very, very little amount of electricity. Okay, so we are bringing it down. Then we can encourage public transport. Wherever there are public transport, we can improve the network, okay? We can improve the number of buses. That's one possibility. And then this, what happens if more people are going to take up the public transport? What happens there? Definitely fuel consumption will reduce. So if 50 people are going to use 50 cars or 50 bikes, and in that place, if you are just going to, all the 50 are going to travel by a bus, definitely imagine the amount of fuel consumption will come down drastically. Then you have the waste materials. That's very important. Many times, what do? If we do not need something, we just throw it away. Instead, we can think of certain things. Like, see, if there is something old, can something useful come out of it? So wealth from waste, that is one thing. And more often, what happens is the waste material of one industry could be used as a raw material for another industry. Thereby, you are lifting up, you're helping one industry to get rid of the waste, and you're also lifting the other industry by providing the raw material. For example, you take bagasse, the sugarcane industry, the sugar industry, the residue that is found is called as bagasse. Now, this bagasse is fibrous, and this is the raw material for making paper, the recycled paper. So just imagine, you are getting the raw material for another industry, paper industry, from the sugar industry. So that's one way of saving the resources and also using the resources. Then recycling of waste. Okay, many, many times, like say paper, we need not throw it away. We need not burn it away. But we can recycle the paper. Recycled paper now is very much in use. And water. So much of water is wasted. Okay. There are two ways of this recycling water. Especially the waste water can be treated again. Okay. When they are treated again, all the unwanted color and the smell and all the unwanted substances are removed from that. It's allowed to sediment and coagulate, and then you get clear, pure water. Of course, it is not potable. It's not fit for human consumption, but we can use it for agricultural purposes. We can use it for ornamental purposes. Okay. So we can definitely use this wastewater that is treated. So what are you doing? You are recycling the water. Okay, then this replacing CFCs. This is another important thing that we can do to tide over the crisis. CFCs are nothing but chlorofluorocarbons. What do? Chlorofluorocarbons are part of our refrigerators, air conditioners, air coolants, then aerosol sprays. All these contain chlorofluorocarbons. Okay, so is there any home without an air conditioner now or a refrigerator now? It has become a necessity. It's not more than a luxury. It's a necessity right now. But what are we supposed to do? If we are going to release these CFCs, they are going to deplete the ozone layer and everything will be disastrous. So what do? We will replace these CFCs. Now we have come across other compounds, like we have hydrochlorofluorocarbons, HCFCs. Like that, there are many other compounds which we can replace these CFCs with. So these are some of the methods by which we can tide over the energy crisis. The first step or the first point that we saw about the possible ways to tide over this energy crisis is to have alternate sources. So that is what we are going to see about. What is the first alternate source? It's the solar energy. Okay. Now when you come to solar energy, it's actually trapping the sunlight or sun's energy and we are converting it into electricity. Okay. And there are two types of doing it. One is the direct one and the indirect one. Now you see this solar panels, they are called as solar panels. And this is actually the world's largest solar panel or the world's largest place where the whole thing is controlled by solar energy is Cochin Airport. Okay, in Kochi, you have these solar panels in such a way that these panels are made of photovoltaic cells. And this is how the cell works. Each cell will work like this. What it does, it traps the sunlight and then it will produce electricity this way. And it will be amazing to know that each day at Kochi Airport, it is able to produce 50,000 to 60,000 units per day. Okay, and the whole airport is controlled, or the electrical part of the electrical energy requirement of the airport is completely provided by the solar panels. Okay, that is the direct one. The indirect one is you have such circular ones or rectangular ones. You can have a mirror or something that can reflect the sun's rays, and that is called as concentrated solar power, CSP. Okay, so that rays are concentrated in one particular area and then that is getting converted. So there are two ways of using the solar energy. And what is the advantage of this is that it is never a day that we don't have sun. Okay, only thing is that sometimes if there is a diffused kind of sunlight and the heat is not enough, the sun's rays are not enough, that is when there is a slight trouble. But otherwise, because now what happens is in the chemical form of chemical energy, the solar energy is transferred and stored. So we can store it and use it for a later date. It is renewable, it is inexhaustible, and it is clean. This is one thing that we need right now. It's the need of the hour is to have every clean source of energy. And this is one source which is clean. And then it also reduces electricity consumption like anything. Nowadays, the government is coming up with subsidies and awards for factories and units and bigger units where they are able to control or they are able to depend on only solar energy so that they are independent of electricity. Like they don't need electricity from other sources at all because solar energy is enough. There are many factories where the roof is completely filled with solar panels like this so that they are able to cater to their own factory. Okay, the next one is the wind energy. Okay, wind energy, what happens is it moves. See here, it's the moving It is always in the direction of the wind. It is, of course, seasonal, but then there's a lot of energy that can be tapped from the wind. So this moving wind, an energy due to movement, is nothing but mechanical energy. So this mechanical energy is converted into electricity. How does it happen? See, in the windmill, you have these blades. There are three blades. These blades are called as vanes. These vanes, the movement of this can create this energy that is helping to move the turbines and then generate electricity. So that's how the wind energy is. And you have wind farms. There are many thousands of wind mills, and these modern wind mills are known as wind turbine generators. So this is the name, WTG, wind turbine generators. Okay. And there are thousands of this placed in some areas where it is very windy. But and the advantage of this is it is, again, this is also non-polluting, and it is inexhaustible and renewable. But the disadvantage of this is that it is seasonal. Okay, sometimes there can be times when the wind is not there at all. So then there is a problem there. And for both the solar panels and for windmills to be installed, the installation cost is very, very high. Not only that, if you look into this as well as this, these two things require a large amount of area. Okay, so a large space is required. At the same time, we also have the cost, the investment. To initially to fix up all this, the initial cost is very, very high for both of these. And the saddest part of this wind energy trapping is that windmills is that when this windmill keeps moving and rotating, the bats and the birds, their mortality is very high, because the birds keep flying in that level, and in that height, they tend to lose their lives. That's very sad. And sometimes due to the vibration and due to the movement of the windmills constantly, you cannot find in that particular area, you cannot find birds at all. They just disappear from that place. So that is the saddest part of the windmills. Okay, next, coming to the biogas. How do we get biogas? The word bio itself says that it's something from life, living organisms. Okay, so all the waste that we get from the living organisms, that's what we call it as biomass. Now we make use of this biomass, not only living organisms, we also take the agricultural residues that are found in the villages. Then you have the industrial waste, which are possible, like not poisonous chemicals, but other things that are there, harmless. Those industrial waste are taken. Not only that, human waste and the dung, cow dung and other things, and the garbage, all these are put together. Okay, so that's how this biogas works here. This is a biogas plant, and now this dung and the water is added here, and then it goes to a digester. And this is done by anaerobic breakdown. What do you mean by that? Breaking down of all this organic matter. So it is just getting digested. It is broken down. Okay, how does it break down? Anaerobic means in the absence of oxygen. Okay, so it is just closed and it is broken down, and then it is mixed up. It is constantly, occasionally it is mixed up, and finally, after it gets broken down, it releases this biogas. Okay, and this gas, sometimes if you see in the remote areas, remote villages, a biogas plant can provide the street lights, lighting is done, and it's also a domestic fuel. So just like we have our LPGs, this biogas plants can provide the fuel for chulas. Okay, so in those villages, in the remote areas where it's so difficult to get fuel, this biogas comes to the rescue. Okay, the advantages of this biogas is that we are using all that is a waste. Okay, it's a wealth from waste. Isn't that wonderful? And also, it does not produce any smoke. Usually when the women used to carry wood from the forest and come and introduce them into the gas, wood stoves or the chulas, what used to happen was a lot of smoke used to be there. And the women used to inhale all that smoke and it used to affect their lungs, their eyes, and so many problems used to be there. But now it's not there anymore because this biogas has no smoke. And it has a high calorific value. What do you mean by that? It produces a large amount of heat. So anything can be done very quickly with biogas. Okay. And the greatest thing is that the residue is also not going waste. After it gets digested, there is a residue that is there right at the bottom. This biomanure can be used as a fertilizer. So that's very good actually for the plants and the trees. Okay, so these are the different sources: solar, wind, and biogas. Not only this, we also have thermal energy, we have tidal energy, we have nuclear energy. But the danger of nuclear energy is that it has to be handled very carefully. And if there is any leakage or the handling of the nuclear waste is a big problem. But as of now, the safest forms are the solar energy, wind energy, and the biogas. Okay, I hope you enjoyed this video. If you have liked it, if you understood it and enjoyed it, don't forget to like, share, and subscribe. Bye-bye.